it's just you and me here now. Deliver me out of the sadness. Deliver me from all of the madness. Deliver me, courage to guide me. Deliver me, your strength inside me. All of my life I've been in hiding, wishing there was someone just like you. Now that you're here, now that I've found you, I know that you're the one to pull me through. Deliver me, loving and caring. Deliver me, giving and sharing. Deliver me, this cross that I'm bearing. All of my life I've been in hiding, wishing there was someone just like you. Now that you're here, now that I've found you, I know that you're the one to pull me through. All of my life I've been in hiding, wishing there was someone just like you. Now that you're here, now that I've found you, I know that you're the one to pull me through. Oh, deliver me. Oh, deliver me.
Jesus. Good evening, everyone. Welcome. Shall we collect together? We're going to worship tonight, passionate worship. It's so great to see you all. How many of you have been at the conference this week during any of the sessions? Okay, that's about a third of you. So a lot of you have not been here before. Did you know it was a conference? Has anyone arrived and you didn't know it was the Trumpet Call conference? One person didn't know. Well, this is a treat for you then. Shall we all stand together and we're going to open in prayer? God is moving powerfully throughout this conference in every single session. There have been times of incredible intensity. He's been doing deep work. He's just going for the deep things. There's nothing that's on the surface. And tonight, I know he's going to do the same thing again. He's going to go deep because it's a trumpet call and the arts are emerging. So the Lord is just removing those things that are going to interfere with the emergence of his plans and purposes for this whole earth, right? Okay, so now we're all ready to go. Let's pray and welcome the Holy Spirit to increase his presence. Thank you again, Father. This is so wonderful to be together. Now, Father, we want to tell you right off, we love you. Father, we appreciate you. We love your hand upon us. We love your wisdom, Father, in directing us. We just love the security of your presence so that we can rest in your arms. And we choose right now to rest. We give you, God, everything we've walked in this building with, every burden. If it's a difficult day here, God, take that yoke from us and we rest in you right now. Holy Spirit, we invite you right now to wash over each one of us. Just begin to wash us and cleanse us afresh. We give you every part of us right now to wash through us, over us, under us, Holy Spirit. And Holy Spirit, we're inviting you to pour in your strength, your joy, your love, your peace, your very presence and life itself. Begin to pour into us that we may worship you as we long to do in abandonment, that you may know over and over and over again, Father, we love you. Father, we love you. Father, we love and adore you. And would you, Father, direct everything that's happening? Be with everyone on the platform as they come on the platform, as they go off the platform. Be with the musicians, Lord. And God, just pour your glory upon this platform. Fill it with angels. And Holy Spirit, you minister the way you want to minister. And we commit together, don't we, Church of God? We commit together to follow your leading, Holy Spirit. Thank you. Amen. Thank you.
The song is called God Has Risen. We can no longer say, let God arise, for he has risen. We can no longer say, let his enemies be scattered, indeed they are fleeing. Amen. Oh God, the nations have invaded. Your inheritance and the holy place. Jerusalem is almost in ruins, while most men just turn away. How long, oh Lord, will you be angry? How long? Then the Lord awoke as if from a sleep, like a warrior overcome with wine. And he drove back his adversaries, and he smote them on their cars his stand in his own congregation. He will
judge in the midst of kings. There is a shaking coming to this generation. The winds of change will blow all things. How long, O Lord, will you watch injustice? How long, O Lord, will you hide your face? Then the Lord awoke as if from a sleep, like a warrior overcome with wine. And he drove back his adversaries, and he smote them on their parts, their high. Well, for God has risen, his enemies have fled, and those who hate him will run before his dread. For the fires are burning that purifies the heart, and the shout of the righteous is just. God said, I'm the first one that said he would smite them on their hinder parts. You have a mighty God. You have a mighty King. He waits no longer. Release the power of his grace. Sing it with me. God takes his stand in his own congregation. He will attend the midst of kings. There is a shaking coming to this generation. The winds of change will blow all things. How long, O Lord, will you watch injustice? How long, O Lord, will you hide your Then the Lord awoke as if from a sleep, like a warrior overcome with wine. And he drove back his adversaries, and he smote them on their parts behind. Oh, for God has risen, his enemies have fled, and in such a way as to win the race. It's not time to compete, but win all the place. Run in such a way as to live in the kingdom. It's time to live for your God. We've been battling with what's in our hearts. Mind is often the enemy. God is calling us to another heart. Live in Jesus and live free. is something of illusion, for it becomes the place that we hide. And unless we come under the wings of His grace, we'll never know why our God has risen and His enemies have fled. And those who hate Him will run before His dread. For the fires are burning that purifies your heart, and the shout of the righteous is just about to start. Walls in your life like Jericho? Are the walls in your life like Jericho? They're broad and they're high, they can support two chariots wide, and there's nothing on this earth that can take it down. So they surrounded the walls and they walked in their silence. They kept right on moving. Then one day they shouted it down. If I just jump higher, if I shout a little more or dance a little harder, everything I need will come flowing to me. But I find instead of attacking the enemy, why not attack the God of eternity? Why not come to the throne and say, I'm not leaving till you bless me? Boldly come forth, boldly come forth.
your God? Who's your King? Rise up, children. Know your redemption is at hand. Rise up, Jericho children. Watch the Lord take the land. Your spirit soars. Now take that ride again. Your hearts were filled once, and you never thought it would come again. But now God is calling, saying you might hear. I'm tearing down your pushing aside your fall, and I'm ever
Interesting night, don't you think? The Lord is moved in your hearts, and you're often wondering where I go from here. I got many an idea, and I got plenty of friends who'll help me do it, but where do I go from here? One thing he's been showing me lately is stop making others do what you are not willing to do. Don't use them to fulfill the vision that you're just too afraid to take hold of in you. If you were made to sing, then sing. If you were made to dance, then dance. If you were made to shout, then shout it out until you find your loving romance. Jesus, Lord, is ever present. He never finds a reason to leave. Jesus, Lord, can hear you even when you fail. So there's no give your anointing to me. This is about giving your anointing away. This is about stirring in your heart that you're afraid to say. I'm what he made, I'm nothing more or less, and I will obey the king that says I made you the best. Run in such a way as to win. That don't mean compete, it means to turn your lives within. Till you feel your God helping you carry his own burden through. Until you know you're through and through, giving up to Jesus. Is this time what you plan, or is this plan? Much confusion round that subject is finally in love. I'd like to see what it means to Jesus when he says, these are mine. I'm sure it's the face of love. I'm sure it's the face of love. Oh.
time about where I'm going, but now the future's shorter. Now I'm losing my mind. When I was young, I reasoned about the future. Now that I'm old, it seems so foolish to waste any more time. But still the question lingers on. I'm sure you know my heart. Where do we go from here? O God of our hearts. If the people who were called by my name will humble themselves and pray, I will hear them. I will hear. If those who can hear me today will harden not their hearts and turn away, I will heal them. I will heal. If the hearts of the children will turn towards the fathers and help them to learn that there's only God to be praised, and we'll worship Him all of our days. Then the Father will save this land, for the blood still flows from His right hand, and the glory of God will fall on those to respond to the call. As a great cloud of witnesses stand, a shout from the earth will ascend. Oh, Jesus is Lord. Oh, Jesus is Lord. Sing it. If we preach to the nations the truth with no reputation of what man can do, He will save them. He will save. Making disciples for Christ, for they've come to the Lord There's been a jailbreak. I'm finally free. Chains on my feet have fallen from me. As I escape these prison walls, I see a man hanging on a cross. He paid the cost. Now I'm a prisoner. I can't explain this mystery. I'm a prisoner, still trying to be free. I'm a prisoner. I'm just as caught as I ever was, but I'm a prisoner. Oh. When I look up, the cross is gone. I see a throne of grace surrounded by a song. He calls my name. I can't turn away. Why I say I'm a prisoner. I can't explain this mystery. I'm a prisoner. I don't want to be free. I'm a I'm just as caught as I ever was, but I'm a prisoner of love. Sometimes I think of those still inside. I can't explain this mystery. I'm a prisoner. I don't want to be free. I'm a prisoner. I'm just as caught as I ever was. I'm a prisoner. Sing it with me. I'm a prisoner. I can't explain this mystery. I'm a prisoner. I don't want to be free. I'm a prisoner. I'm just as caught as I ever was. I'm a prisoner.
Get him, God.
Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
You look beautiful. You look absolutely wonderful. Ah, beautiful people of God, full of passion. They're moving all over the place. Isn't that wonderful, Veronique? Ah, if you haven't been with us all week, you've walked in to an arts conference that is just for you. Because the arts speak to you. It's Jesus giving you messages all tonight. So just open your heart and receive and receive and receive, okay? And have a wonderful time. Pharaoh has a few words for us.
All right. I was so fascinated by the potter during the worship and just thinking about how God is the potter, and that's us. It's just amazing all the care, the attention she has for each piece, and all different and beautiful. That's us. So I just want to go over a few things before we get into the fun stuff. Well, actually, this is a fun one. We have an area upstairs, just if you go up the stairs, we call it above the mezzanine, where the floor is covered and there's tables there where people can paint or draw and just think about being a watchman on the wall. It's a good place to be. And we just protected the area there, so it's all ready for you. If you have your paint, you can go up there. Just don't use oil paint for fire regulations. Also, we mentioned already a few times, but just once again, we have those testimony forms in the lobby. And if God has been doing good stuff in your heart, in your lives during the conference, please grab one of those, and there's a box where you can put it. And we'd love to hear what God is doing and be able to share it with others. One other thing. Did you enjoy the worship tonight? I love Don Potter and his wife. I just think I want to be like her. Just such freedom. He has a lot of products in the resource center. I just brought three of them up here. There's Facing the Wall. I actually got that one. I didn't even know it was an instrumental, and I played it. At the time, I was working in a cafe, and we were supposed to put, you know, ambiance music. So I put that, and people were like, "What is this? So amazing!" I'm like, "Yeah, it's a Christian," and you know, just it just opened the door for me to share about Jesus, and it's just wonderful anointing. Now is the time. We sang one of those songs yesterday, I think, Enlarge Your Tent and Give Them Up. It's on that CD. Very powerful. And then Since the Fall. There's a lot of other ones, and he's also on a lot of the Morningstar CDs that we have in the Resource Center. couple more things. We have a lot of conferences, a lot of stuff going on at TACF, and two things that are happening this summer. We have Families on Fire, which is, you know, the title says it, a conference centered around the family and just ministering to the kids, to the parents, and just all sorts of stuff that have to do with families. It's really fun. That's July 3rd to the 5th. And also Releases of Life, which is a women's conference. We won't kick the men out, but if men come, they might just not benefit as much, you know, but who knows. That's July 29th to August 1st. And Mary Audrey was emceeing last night. She leads that ministry, Releases of Life, and it's just wonderful what God does in the lives of women through her ministry. She's bringing Releases of Life actually all across the world right now, and she's amazing. So I think that's it for the announcements.
Thank you, Vero. Something wonderful is happening up here. I was sitting down listening to the announcements, and I started hearing a sound. I could hear a trumpet up here, and another trumpet, and another trumpet, and all of a sudden, there was like this chorus of trumpeting on the platform. The angels are trumpeting. Oh. The angels are trumpeting, and I wonder what they're trumpeting. Oh, I want my ears open to hear what they're trumpeting. Do you? Okay, let's stand up. Jesus, can you just say his name? Jesus. Jesus. Oh, Jesus, thank you that there's a chorus of angels trumpeting right now. Jesus, open our ears. We give them to you right now, the ears of our spirit. Open them up. God, let us hear not just the sound of the trumpet, but God, let us hear what you're trumpeting tonight. We want to hear what you're trumpeting, and God, I hear a trumpet and a trumpet and a trumpet is coming from all directions, God. So, Lord, speak clearly tonight. Let your voice be heard. Deep, deep from within, let it bubble up. Bubble up into our hearts and our minds. We will hear a clear trumpeting of our Jesus tonight. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Amen. Wow. Wow. I know you can't. It's hard to sit, isn't it? It's hard to sit when the trumpets are trumpeting. So you can stand if you want to stand. There are some interesting things in the building that, because so many of you have not been here this week, I'll take just 1 minute to talk about. There is a series of art, a project. It's even hard to talk. I hear the trumpets. But you'll see the project here to my left. It's a journey. And this particular one, you might want to gingerly touch it with very clean or anointed hands. Just touch lightly. It's gone to so many nations. This very collection has flown to so many nations. And you know what it's doing? It's often third world nations. It ministers to those who have faced extreme adversity and trauma. So often it's in nations where there's war, it's where there's violence. It ministers to those who've experienced rape, extreme abuse. You know, this very collection, another print and set of it, is in a prison in Colombia, and it stays there permanently. Isn't that amazing? It's one of the emerging arts that has such an anointing on it for healing. And I want to invite you, if you haven't been here all week, you need to spend days with it. But why don't you take a look at a little bit of it tonight? There's so much detail, and it tells of a journey of pain. And that journey is very real. It depicts, it's beautifully detailed. And it shows in the journey how the one comes to the Lord. And it ends with the wedding of the Lamb and the bride, the wedding supper. It's incredible. And you can lose yourself in each one. But you know what? There's a description there for us, because, like, I need a description sometimes to understand it, because I want to understand quickly. But those who have experienced that type of pain, James Tugan, who is the artist, tells me, no one needs to tell them what it's about. No one needs to explain the meaning of each one of those art pieces, because they look in there and they can read it. It speaks the language of their experience in their heart. And they go through this series, and it comes to tremendous healing. So I just wanted you to know, because that's something you don't see every day, right? I've never seen anything like it before. And we have art all over the place. In the back, which is closed now, we've set up a gallery. And the most amazing pieces, art in artisans, is there. And it's open, only open 2 hours a day. So you need to come back tomorrow, 1 to 2. And 6 to 7, that gallery is open. And believe me, you don't want to miss it. And you're just going to be amazed at what God does through the artists and artisans. And art photography is there as well, all very anointed. What you might have noticed when you came in is on the office parking lot, there are a series of tents. Who noticed the tents? It's called The Experience. And there's a reason for that. Can I have the Lovers of God Quebec Je T'aime group just stand up for a moment if you're still with us here? Yeah. Oh, you got to applaud these guys. Yeah. Yay, we love you. We so appreciate what you've done for us. And you have ministered to us. Oh, the heart of Jesus. They have ministered. Quebec artists and artisans have ministered to us all week. For those of you who haven't had a chance to go into The Experience, let me tell you, I saw a DVD on that months ago, and then I said to Steve, I really want these guys to come with their experience. You go in the first tent, and I had seen on the DVD, the first tent is like going into the womb again. It's about the rebirth. It's all about the rebirth. People go in it who have never met the Lord, because it goes to secular festivals. It's gone to many cities, and it's gone to ministries, so that people who have been away from the Lord or embittered by their experiences within church, and or just drawn away or drawn cold, they go into this experience. And they come out so moved in tears. And the Lord himself meets them. Father meets them in there. The presence of God is in the experience. So I knew all this, right? I knew the lost could go in there that just came off the street, see the tents and think, oh, this is a neat thing. Let's try this. Go in and come out so moved because they've experienced God for maybe first time in their life without preaching. But preaching's good. But without preaching, with the arts, ministering and representing God for them. So I knew and saw the DVD, and I thought, you know, I'm going to love it, but I know what to experience. And I go in the first tent, and I sit down, and there I am in the womb, and I hear, Je t'aime, I love you, you are my beloved. And I mean, it just sounds like words right now, but when I sat down, somehow, the memory of the womb and just being there in the very first moments of my life, it was like it was real. And God was there. And the tears just instantly welled up. I never expected this. Just didn't expect it. I was so greatly moved. And then you go through the cleansing, you go through the birth canal, and you come out, and there's a whole series. I'm not going to give it away, because there's some places in there that are so powerful in that experience. And then you come out, and there's this wonderful prophetic team, like we have at TACF. They brought their own prophetic team, and sit down, and they just wait upon the Lord and just say the most wonderful things from the heart of God right to you. I don't know of another ministry like this anywhere. Never heard of anything like this anywhere. And you know the team, Lovers of God, Quebec Chatham team, they take it to all kinds of places, and it's by faith. They don't charge a cent. Like this conference, they just open the doors and say, come, experience God. So, you know where they're going after this week? You know, some of you know already, you heard. Well, Quebec City, right? Quebec City, and that 400th year anniversary. You know they're coming from all over the world to Quebec City? Thousands. And they're going to be in a very strategic place. And I'm just not going to tell you, because Hanny said the other night where they were going. Historically strategic. God miraculously opened up that space that they could bring the experience there. Quebec. Minister to us this week. And they have poured hour upon hour upon hour, graciously loving us, painting it, and doing so much. That tapestry right back there, that was created by Joanne LeDuc and her team. I think she's probably upstairs. Are you here, Joanne? Jump up and wave. She's up there painting some more. The girl never stops. She's an artist, and she does many forms of art, and it just pours out of her. I couldn't get over it this week. They ministered to us, and now they're going to Quebec. People of God, can we pour into them tonight? And as we pour into them, we're pouring into Quebec. We're pouring into what God can do as thousands are coming from around the world, because they've done the big tourism bit on it. And we can minister to our lovely Belle province, Quebec. So we want to give, as we do at every conference, we want to give this missions offering to Lovers of God and Quebec Jetem. We want it seed into them, because they've so poured into us, and we want Quebec all alive with the love of God, and free with the love of God. All of them free, because they have such a strategic place as the heart of our nation. And we just plain love them in this house. We love Quebec in this house. So I'm going to ask you to give generously, because these people are a people of the heart, and they've given to us so generously. And you're giving to Jesus, because it is not Lovers of God in those tents. They have done what God gave them the design for. It is God that you're giving to tonight. It's His presence in the tents that are changing lives. Changing lives without words, really. Okay? So I'm going to ask those who are taking the offering. Do we have people tonight who are doing that? Who, just show yourself quickly. We do. So I'll ask Don Potter to lead us in worship, and just invite you to give as much as you can to Jesus tonight. Thank you.
When all the world is a hopeless jumble, and the raindrops tumble all around, heaven opens a magic lane. And all the clouds
Darken up the skyway. There's a rainbow highway to be found, leading from your window pane. Somewhere over the rainbow, way up high, there's a land that I've heard of. Once in a lullaby, oh, somewhere over the rainbow, sky blue, and the dreams that you dare to dream really do come true. Someday I'll wish upon a star, wake up where the clouds are far behind me. Where troubles melt like lemon drops, way up above the chimney tops, that's where bluebirds fly. Birds fly over the rainbow. Why then, oh, why can't I? Birds fly over the rainbow. Why then, oh, why can't I?
There are so many incredibly gifted, creative people here and have been here all week, but we just want to bring some of the really, really interesting ones to you tonight. Not that they aren't all interesting, but these are, wow. So could I have Peter Rizma come up? And we had our potter here, Cynthia Stevens, and Anita. And Anita's got something I personally asked her to bring this week, and I'll tell you why in a moment. But as they're getting all ready, this group meet together, and I had the privilege of going to one of their meetings recently on a Monday night. They are from Mississauga. At least that's where the church is. And this wonderful man, Peter, I just met a short while ago. But can I tell them, I know you, can I please tell them, since I TACF, he said go ahead, because this thrilled me. And I said to Peter, this is why, one of the reasons why God is giving this conference to us. Peter has been coming for years. He's from another church, but he comes generally Friday nights. And for years, he's been sketching in a sketchbook when he comes. And the anointing would come on him in this house, and he would sketch. I hadn't a clue that was happening. But I believe it's those types of things that have prepared the ground. And because of Peter and artists and musicians and dancers and that, like Peter, who have been coming here, I think that's a reason why this healing well, this TACF ministry, has been so blessed to be able to host the presence of God with an arts conference. So I thank you, Peter. He is just the most wonderful guy and a conceptual artist. I've just learned what that is. So no more of me. There you go,
Pete. Thanks, April. Whoa. There's a lot of anointing up here, and I may fall over. But it's so good to see you all here. I feel like this is family with all these artists here. I feel really at home. I'm a third of a group of artists called Burnt Offerings. We meet at our church three times a month, and we paint and do pottery. This is Cynthia. Cynthia does pottery. You've already seen her. And Anita, the one with the large painting. We meet three times a month, and once a month we go all night. We don't stop. We might sleep for 1 hour or 2 hours, and by about 3 a.m., we can hardly, sometimes we can't work anymore. We just fall on a carpet, and we're glued to the carpet. It's like the presence of God, the throne of God is right there with us. And this has been an amazing experience. We've learned to work together. We've learned not to compete with each other, which is a miracle in a way. And it's been a lot of fun. I want to talk a little bit about this painting here that Cynthia's holding. I don't know if you can focus your camera on it, so it's on the screens. Recently, two of us went on a mission trip as artists. Anita and I went on a mission trip as artists, and we had no idea what artists would do on a mission trip, but we went anyway. We went to a North African country, and we started to sketch, and we prayed. We visited several towns, and we prayed at all the gates. We did intercession. We worshiped every morning, and afternoons we went out and sketched and painted and drew. And this painting comes out of that experience. In a lot of countries, there is no root. You're going to have to put your anointed thinking caps on for a minute. Sorry. A lot of countries, there's no language to express what Jesus Christ and the Father and the Holy Spirit is. Even among Christians, they don't have any visual language. And I thought I'd pose myself the question, how would we show the living Father, Son, and Holy Spirit coming into a town where 99.89% of the residents are Muslim? And this is what I came up with. When you're in that land, there's a call for prayer 4 or 5 times a day. There's a religion of obedience there. And I wondered, how could I paint breaking into that religion of obedience? This desperate attempt to be obedient and desperate, make it a desperate call to God, the Father, where there's a relationship of love between Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, which I denoted with the three colors, which come out of the colors that were used in the tabernacle. If you're still with me, let me know. I, So I really wanted to assault that stronghold with this picture, and I want it to go there when it's complete, when it's finished. I'm going to make copies and send it out to people that we've met there. I'm going to turn the mic over to Anita right now, and she'll talk about her painting.
Can I say something first about it? Yeah. Do you want to say something? It's still wet. Okay. Was this the one that was painted at the conference? It was painted in Africa.
It was started in Africa. This is not one of the ones that I started at the conference. There are two of my paintings in the gallery which were developed here as sketches initially.
Ah, visit the gallery and see more. I saw, because he showed me three paintings a few weeks ago, and I didn't understand what he meant by conceptual artists, but it has something to do with the intellectual, I believe, approach. He would probably, I'm afraid so, he says. Okay. So I got it. He was showing me three different ones, and he started to talk about the next one. My eyes were riveted on this one because I could just feel the anointing, and I had to figure it out or have the Holy Spirit explain to me. So he's chattering on about the next painting, and I can't leave this one. You'll get it. I know you'll get it because you're so prophetic. So you have to picture this. Their profile of faces, several of them, the ones following the Lord, who follow the Spirit of Truth, their faces are like on a blue banner, superimposed, or else the sheer organza blue banners over them. That's kind of the way I would describe it. And they're going this way. Then underneath, in another color banner, what's the color, Peter?
Is it reds and roses?
Okay. So imagine faces in profile with like an organza banner over of reds and roses colors. You got it? You're creative arts people. They're facing this way. And I suddenly got it because they were the little superimposed, those banners. The blue banner, it came down over the faces, the profiles of the red-orange banner over the minds. But they were going opposite directions. And this is what I got. When we are filled with the Spirit of Truth, revelation in our renewed minds, right? The Spirit of Truth in our minds. We don't have to say anything necessarily. In our everyday life, we're carrying the Spirit of Truth. And we can be bypassing, just walking and bypassing other people. But that Spirit of Truth is so powerful on us. We carry that. That it's affecting the minds of those who do not know or follow the Lord. You cannot help but affect those around you. And that was represented on the art. And when I looked at it, and Peter, he didn't tell me that, I suddenly got it. The revelation that no matter where I go, whatever Spirit of Truth is already in my renewed mind is affecting the minds of others. Isn't that just an incredible revelation? And that was it. I got that from the painting. So thank you very much. There's the power of conceptual art. Now, I am responsible for this painting being here because the day that Anita was working on it, it wasn't finished yet. I've just seen the finished one now. When she was working on it, I was there and I saw it. We weren't talking about it, but I saw it over there. But the anointing on it kept coming towards me. You know, God, David, you spoke about this. David Costello spoke about this morning, that he is looking for a painting when he paints again that has the very anointing of God on it, and he will not settle for anything less. Well, I'm sitting listening to these people, but the anointing is coming off this unfinished painting. So I asked Anita to explain it to me because I didn't understand it. But I knew the Holy Spirit was on it. it's gorgeous, what the skin tones and everything. Never bothered me that they were naked, because I thought, well, It just never bothered me. And then when I thought about it later, because I realized I had asked for it to come and hang in the church, I remembered in the Garden of Eden, that was normal for us when we were innocent. It was normal. It was the way it was meant to be when Father would come and walk in the garden with us. So I hope it doesn't bother you, because we started out this way, right? And I asked her to bring it, and please tell us what this is all about, okay? Because you'll be blessed as I was blessed. Thank you, Anita.
Well, this is a journey that's been going for quite some time. Probably about 5 years ago, I had a picture of the resurrection, and I wanted to paint it. But God said, no, you can't do that yet, because you got to go through the cross. How can you go straight to resurrection? It doesn't work that way. So I began a series working with the body of Christ as a metaphor for what was going on internally rather than externally. So none of them have wounds on them. The one in the gallery is the third one in the series. This is the fourth. So it was about a year ago when kind of I was being pushed to start the next one, and I knew it had to be about death. And then without even realizing it, but my life began to parallel what God was teaching me about Christ's death. And I began dying to things in my life. And so while I was in the middle of this dying, it had been going on for about 3 months or so, I woke up with a dream. And in the dream, I was in a womb. And it was like, yes, the rest of the picture. Because I hadn't started yet at this point. It was just kind of growing in my mind. I knew what I wanted Jesus to look like, but I didn't know what this big space was going to be. So when I had that dream, I just knew it had to be about a womb. So here it is. And the interesting thing is it took me 9 months to paint. And if April, you hadn't given me a due date, I would have been overdue. I'm not sure if I've been born yet, but it has been, so that's the first step. And just to kind of give you a bit of an understanding, I guess, how to read it, is I'm trying to explore what was happening on Saturday. So Jesus died on a Friday, he was raised on a Sunday. What was going on Saturday, and where were we, and were we part of that? A really interesting thing happened with a song one morning. I woke up and I heard these words going through my head, and they're actually part of a Jeremy Riddle song. And God took one of the words, room, and he flipped it and said tomb instead. And the words that I heard were, in the quiet of my tomb, in the stillness, I hear your voice call, and I am overwhelmed. I am lost for words to describe you. Now, the way Jeremy Riddle wrote it, it was supposed to be Jeremy talking to God, but God flipped it on its head, and he said, that's Jesus talking to you. And so it was this, huh, could it be on Saturday, after the it is finished, that he kind of rested a while, and his blood drained from him, and fed this womb, fed this place where we could grow, all of us? Could it be on Saturday that Jesus, for the first time, heard us as a redeemed people? So these are kind of the things that went through my head as I was going. So I just encourage you to enter into that place and be there with him on Saturday.
Oh, I just love Cynthia Stevens. She mailed me her DVD about how she teaches about the potter and the clay and pottery and the worship she does. She's been on the platform during worship because what she does is worship. So we just want her to say a little bit about what this is all about for her. And I love you, Cynthia. I love what you do. You've taught me. I had never, ever thought about what this potting is, worship. But I learned so much from you, and thank you.
You're welcome.
she reminds me of a flower, you know? Doesn't she? Just beautiful. Yes, pottery is worship for me. The Lord pulled me back into it 8 years ago, 7.5 years ago, and it became a communion time of Him and me. And it's where He taught me about Himself in a very deep and profound way. So what I did here wasn't just sort of, well, it was play, of course, but it is worship. It's intercession for me often because it's clay and it comes from the land. It gets dug up. I try to listen to Him and to the land and, intercede for what He speaks. So I want to just, So I made these four pots here, pondering about Psalm 139, where it says that we are fearfully and wonderfully made. Now, we've heard that lots, and I can get a handle on that we're wonderfully made by God, but that we're fearfully made, like God, when He made us, was full of fear and full of wonder. If that doesn't level you, I don't know what will. Now, what does that mean? Well, in this place, at this time, see how they're all different shapes, of course, because no two are the same, right? Because He's a one-of-a-kind artist. He doesn't make junk, and He doesn't duplicate. So we're all very, very different. And then what He does is He pours in expressions of Himself, expressions of His character, and in this place where there's piles of creativity in every single one of you, He calls us to pour it out, right? He calls us to express it in the unique way that you must do. I mean, He calls us up to that, full of fear and full of wonder. It's how He made you, so it is how we must live, called up, full of fear, full of wonder. How do we express what He's poured into us? That was one thing I thought maybe you needed to hear again. Now, this pot here, this is the last thing I'm going to say. All right.
Go like this.
You have to kind of eat it. Yeah. So this conference, I think what's happening is that He's turning things on its head a little bit in the church and in us. And then what He's doing is He's like shaking us. This could be dangerous, but I'm going to do it anyway. Because what He's doing is shaking old mindsets out of us. Right? Gone. Shaking out ideas and attitudes that we have about Him that are so off base. Just gone. Shake it out. You know? Shaking out old ways. Shaking out offenses. Things that have held us back. Just shake them out. Now, that's intriguing. It's now just a little lopsided. I didn't predict that. Sometimes when I've done this, it gets a curvy edge. But not today. Now we have to wonder about that. Maybe it's because I need to just change the shape. See, stuff happens with clay, and then you just have to kind of, okay, God, what does that mean? So, I'm just going to change this shape because, actually, that's all I'm going to do to it. Because it is the strangest picture I've ever seen. It just needs a handle, right? And then it is a picture. So we will be poured out. We will be. We'll be a drink offering, right? Just like Christ. So bless you to do that, to live it. Drink in and then pour out for him as creative people.
Could you stay up here with me? Isn't that wonderful? I just asked Peter and Cynthia and Anita, could you come here? We want to pray for you. These three represent unique emerging arts ministries all throughout this room. They're just three representing you. I want to bless the emerging arts. Would you like to do that? Why don't you stand and just stretch towards them your hand of blessing, and let's pray for them. And we want them to have more, right? Because these three, they soak in the Spirit. They receive what they get because they're with the Lord. And that's our value, right? So stretch your hands. Okay, Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, for them and for all represented in here, Lord, we are blessing the emerging arts in them. We are blessing it. And Holy Spirit, we say more. Just say more, Holy Spirit. More revelation for them. More deep revelation. And Lord, we ask, open the doors. Open the doors for them to minister. Lord, we call forth ministry. They mentioned the nations. They've already been to the nations. Lord, may the nations be blessed through them. Blessed through them. And God, bring us to a maturity. It's all right, a maturity and a new understanding of the emerging arts that are coming forward. Give us a spirit of revelation and truth that we will see it. We will see it, whether it's in movement, whether it's in from an artisan or an artist or a musician or a dancer or a writer or a mime, and we will understand. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Amen. Okay, thank you so much. Could Andy, of Sound Ministry, come forward? Are you here, Andy? This is a young ministry that's doing exciting things. Andrew, he's coming. Please come up, Andrew. I am thrilled that Andrew's here. He has a ministry called Sound Ministry. I'm going to read a few words on here because, wow, got my attention. Techno. Trance, drum, and bass breakbeat. I mean, I don't even understand what that is, so I need him to explain to me. It's a powerful worship intercessory ministry.
How's everybody doing tonight? Just so excited just to be around so many people of like creative like minds. And yeah, my name's Adam, and I started this ministry with Andrew Jolie, who's actually over in the youth right now. We started it about a year ago, and there's a video that's supposed to play right now, so if it plays, I'm going to keep talking until it plays, and then I'll... There we go. So as you can see from the video, got a little taste there. We're basically a club ministry that we have an event every month right now. And basically it's the first Saturday of every month that we have it. And really just what happens there, as you can see, we set it up kind of like a club. We have DJs that come and they basically minister through the music. They're basically our worship leaders. And they get up and we have people that sing over top of the music, prophetic singing, prophetic emceeing. We break it down in the middle with like really like we try to have a focus of worship in the middle. And people paint. It's like such an anointing of painters in this place. Well, there's like so many anointed painters. I'm just blown away by the creativity that God is moving in so many new and amazing ways. And God's just really moving through this type of music. We've had people come out and just have experiences with God. The Holy Spirit comes down. People just worshiping and dancing and just really getting filled with the Spirit. And it's just God really wants to move powerfully through the club culture. Just in throughout the night, we break it down. We even share a little bit of word and poetry and different things. We have just a vision just to unite Christians just across the board that are interested in this type of thing, build strong community, bring out the creativity, breathe just a breath of God into the club culture. We really have a vision of not just building Christian community, but taking that community into the club culture and just invading the club culture and seeing just all the kids on the drugs, on the ecstasy, just coming in and just seeing what life is really about. They think that life is about, you know, just partying. The music is great. The music's great. They think that it's all about the music and the drugs, but they got to come and feel Jesus. Because I personally came out of the rave scene, and I did all those drugs. And I tell you, God could do better than that. How many of you could agree? Yeah. Amen. The next one is actually tomorrow night. If anybody wants to head down, we're going to be going to like about midnight or after midnight. You're all welcome to come down after. It's right downtown. Just invite you all out to that. You could either speak to me or speak to Andy. There's some info on the back table there. You can grab, I have my contact card there. You could either email me through the website or you can gather my information off the back there. But we would love any of you that think that you can add to tonight. We're looking for people to get involved. We're looking for people that would love to just come out and dance, be part of the community, painters, prophetic singers, MCs, dancers. We're in need of a lot of different things of, I have a list here because there's just, the vision is huge. We want people to, if you're a drummer, we love to break it down in the middle. We have like a four-piece drum. We had two drum kits going last time with like bongos, drummers, trumpets. It was amazing. It just went nuts and God was really exalted. So we really love to break it down. Percussion is huge if you're a hand drummer. Artists, DJs, any type of musicians, if we could fit you in somehow, it'd be really great. We're in need of people for ministry team and intercession. If you love to paint, we're going to have people painting there tomorrow night. Just come and talk to me after. I'll be around for a little bit or just grab some information in the back.
Does age matter, Adam?
Let me tell you this. On our first event, we had senior citizens getting down. So. Young, old, it doesn't matter. You can worship God to this music. The music does get loud, but we do have earplugs for those who are a little bit older, I guess. I use earplugs, but it's just the same thing to do.
I'm excited because it sounds like whatever instruments, whatever people who would like to come, they just talk to you guys and somehow you fit them in. I heard you say you fit them in.
Yeah, we have many different ways. It's different. The core center of the night, we like to incorporate live music. It's going to be different every time, but this division is huge. We would love to see like violins come in, and we have sometimes high energy, sometimes soaking music. So there's just opportunity to grow the community. So
I love it. I love it. Just stay there, right there. Stand up. I mean, this is incredible, isn't it? And when I love that beat. Okay, let's stretch our hands. Wow. Father, I just feel like thanking you, Father, that this ministry is already birthed. Thank you for Adam and Andrew and all those who are involved in this ministry. God, we're putting a blessing on it right now. We bless it. We bless you, Adam. We bless you, Andrew, we bless you, sound ministry, to grow, to have the Holy Spirit draw the right people to you. And we thank you, Holy Spirit, that you are in there and that you're leading every single night. that they are meeting, that the wind of your spirit is orchestrating who's coming, which instruments, which artists. And God, we thank you for it. I can't just say we thank you so much, God. And Lord, we ask for a growth that is healthy and that will be strong, and that you would right now bring your wing over it, your mighty wing. Tuck this ministry in close to your heart. And Father, you fly them where you want them to go. You fly them in the spirit where you want them to go, protected by your wings. Lord, fly them where you're going, God. You know exactly where you're going with them. I thank you for their willingness, their passion, and bring those around them who will pray for them. Bring in the intercessors, God, to be as passionate about this ministry as they are, to be on board day and night, watching and praying on the wall. God, again, we just thank you for them, and we're blessing sound ministry as the body of Christ. We're blessing sound ministry in the name of Jesus. Amen. Oh, I love the emerging arts. Wow. Awesome. Thank you. We're going to ask Don to come forward and speak with us tonight.
Pretty wild, isn't it? It was interesting to sing a what might be called a secular song in the church, especially for an offering. I thought the Lord was trying to show me something one time, that he said there's a lot more world in the church than you think, and there's a lot more church in the world than you think. Did I say that backwards? Did I say it right? Okay. Forgetting faster these days. Lord, we thank you for tonight. We thank you that you are investing. And the trumpet sounds that were heard are the announcements for a birthing. There's a birthing coming. And it's being birthed in this church, actually. And being birthed in this town and in this area and then in this nation. It will not be denied its birth, but remember, around everything that God has birthed, there's always a lot of death. And so it's time for the intercession to stand and to take charge and to cover and to guard that with which God has placed here and in the house. We pray, Father, now that you will complete this work. You will awaken all the intercession that needs to come to pass. You will awaken all the warriors and all those or intended to move in the spirit concerning the arts and move in the spirit concerning evangelism in its new form. And we pray that awaken now in the name of Jesus, and that it will never go asleep again. In the name of Jesus. Change is good, but change is scary. Isn't it true? You find yourself afraid every time somebody tries something new, like the little, you know, the sound thing. That's really cool. But doesn't that sound a little bit like the world? Sounds exactly like the world. Is that bad? I don't know. Is that bad? You think about it for a second. One time in our church that I led worship in for such a long time, I had a guy come in who played steel guitar in Nashville. We're from Nashville, Tennessee. Steel guitar is very common. He loved the Lord Jesus. He always wanted to be in a worship band, and he said, "Can I play with you?" I said, "Yeah, man, come on." Great musician. And when the session was over, one of the leaders said, "Gee, it sounded awfully country today." I assume that meant that was evil. We'll have to deal with that later. I've been in the music business almost all of my life, and God ran me down when I was 35. My grandmother prayed for me for 30 years, and God said, "I've heard enough prayer. You're coming with me whether you want to or not." So if you're praying for somebody, I want to tell you, don't stop, because sooner or later God will get sick of that prayer, and he'll grab that person by the ear and say, you're coming with me. I've been a professional musician. I guess I was born that way, I think. But I told the Lord, you've really done something wise. You know, I can really do great things for you. I am a professional musician, after all, and I can make things really happen. Oh, I'm so glad we brought you into the kingdom then, Don. That's when he told me, your grandmother has prayed for you for 30 years. And I said, oh my goodness, really? He said, yeah, I'd have taken you out of hell just to stop her prayers. I was forever grateful, actually. I want to talk about a very interesting subject. It's kind of got a couple of little different things, and it turns left a couple of times. It's got a lot of insulting things in there. Hopefully it will offend everybody. And then I go back to America, and Steve can fix everything later. So, there's something about the burden of God's presence, and I know that this is a creative kind of conference and gathering, and many of you are painters, and some of you are musicians, I assume. How many musicians might be here? Oh, there is a good many of you. Okay, good, good. We'll try to get those arrows out of your back later. There's something in the scripture that was always fascinating to me, and I'll tell you just a little brief history. You know about God being stuck in a box at one point during the time when God was carried around in the Ark of the Covenant. It was the only time we ever got God in a box. We actually been trying to get him back in there for a long, long time, but he said when he got out, he said, I'm wrecking the box and getting rid of it, and I'm not going back. So Indiana Jones found it, but other than that... It's been gone for a long time. Now, what wound up happening to the box is that the Levites, which were the artisans and the creative people of Israel, not that everybody else wasn't creative, but they were commissioned to be creative. Every Levite, 48,000, had to be musicians, and they had to know the scriptures by heart, the five books of the Torah. You didn't get to play in the temple until you were 30 years old. And then you only got to play in the temple by being drawn by straws. They drew your name or your straw, short straw, and you got to be a musician in the temple. We all qualified, but only 2,000 were drawn. How'd you like to be qualified and not get selected? Anybody feel that already? Feel that? It's like, well, don't you think he would be smart enough to just get the good musicians and bring them? No, what it does when you draw the straws is it lets God have an opportunity to select who he wants to have in the temple to minister to him. That's what that was for. Be reminded that he didn't keep the same 2,000 for 99 years. That was a shift. So you'd get another shot at it maybe in a couple of years, so you don't get sweaty like you can't go there. So this is what I'm happening. Now, the Ark of the Covenant was behind a veil. Do you all know this? Is everybody aware of what I'm saying? Or am I a little fishy here? It was behind a veil, and it was a cool place to be if you were really extremely wonderful. You got picked as a priest to go in there and minister to the Lord. It was an interesting job. I will give you a very brief, I don't know what I'm really talking about in this area, but it's said that there was ropes tied around their feet when they went in to minister to the presence of the Lord. Some said that's not true, some say it is. And they had little bell-type things on their garments so that if they got in there and had a bad idea and the bell stopped ringing, they knew this guy was dead. And they would drag him out from underneath the drapes with a rope. Thank you very much. So... want to go worship God with me in the Holy of Holies? Some of that has to do with our God is ever as holy as he was and is and will remain that way. But because of the blood of Jesus, the veil was rent. Now, we can all enter in the Holy of Holies, though we don't do it very much. We are capable of entering the Holy of Holies through the cross. There's no sneaking around the back of the tent, checking out what the Holy of Holies looks like. Are you catching me? It's still a bad thing to sneak up on unless you go through the cross. Then you got your good thing. Now, here's what happened many, many years ago, and this is 2 Chronicles 35:3, and I'll read it to you. King Josiah was the first king of Israel that was 8 years old when he began to reign. Something about being 8 and reigning a nation. At any rate, he determined that they needed to do something different. And I'll just read this to you. King Josiah said unto the Levites that taught all Israel, which were holy unto the Lord, but the holy ark, put the holy ark with which Solomon, the son of David, king of Israel, did build. Take this burden. This shall not be a burden upon your shoulders anymore. Now take this and put it into the tabernacle or into the temple. So the burden of the presence of God is no longer on the shoulders of the Levites. That's what it means. So when you come to church next week and the band is supposed to make you worship whether you want to or not, it's really not their responsibility. Believe it or not, it's yours. I know that seems funny. So if you want to see this from another vision, you got one part of the box and they got one part of the box. And if you let your part of the box go down, then they're dragging it around. How good does it look to see God, the presence of the king, being dragged around the room by only those who are trying to force you into getting there? It'd be wiser for you to go ahead and agree to it right away and say, you get your part, I'll get mine, we'll get this thing carried. Now, are you hearing me? I'm really paraphrasing fast because I have some other things that might even be important. Now, here's what happened later. God was interested in being carried around. And he was called a burden. It's a funny word. God was called a burden. Then Let me give you this little word. This is important. God is making a sound now in the heavens. And it is beginning to reverberate on the earth. And all that is creative must respond to that sound. You will paint something, you'll dance something, you'll sing something, you'll play something, you'll do something. You will not be able to stay still. And as the arts, this is an arts, whatever, conference. How many of those have you had in the past? How many of you have heard of in the church? Did you know there's an arts thing happening in Toronto right this minute? This is their second annual one. Is there a focus on the arts at the moment? I think probably so. Their first one had how many people? 1 million. Came to the first. This is your first. Maybe you'll have 1 million at your second one. Yikes. What do people think? Why are they doing that? Why are they coming? Why do we hear a sound? That's why they're coming. That's why you're here. You don't really, really have a reason. Now, we have a few things we're going to have to get over before we get there, but you'll get it. It'll help you after a while. John 6:45. We'll just read this to you in case you can't find your Bible. It is written in the prophets. Jesus is speaking here. It is written in the prophets, and they shall all be taught of God. Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Jesus said this. Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. So the Father's producing a sound, correct? How could you hear it if he wasn't doing it? So if you hear it, you'll come to him. Now, how's he producing that sound? Now, that probably would be a question that would take a long time to answer, but one of the ways he produces it is through prophetic music. How's he do that? Well, first of all, he breaks the musician into 10,000 pieces after he raised them up. Just like a pot, one of these potters, you've heard of that. And then they slowly puts it all back together and says, how do you like being back together now? Okay, I'm a little smashed, but I'm doing fine. Okay, do you mind if I pour something into you? Okay, that'd be fine. Do you mind if I sing a song to you, Don? Okay, that'd be fine. How's your brain? I don't know, I don't have it anymore. Isn't that it? I learned to sing songs in the spirit on the lawnmower. Hey, you laugh. Whenever I get into anything that makes a consistent sound, I have to, after a while I'm singing and I gotta have something. You know, and it's just a sickness. Some kind of a disease that happens to a musician. But so I was riding along one time, like I was really thinking hard. I was, I'm really thinking about Jesus, you know. And he sang something to me. And I went, whoa, that was cool. Right in the rhythm of the motor of the lawnmower. I mean, that was really cool. And so I waited for something else. And then I could feel him saying, sing something back to me. I said, boy, man, what you just sang was so cool. I don't know that I, he says, why don't you sing that back? Oh, okay. So I sang it back. Isn't that cool? That's great. So he sings another thing, and I sing that back to him. And then we start this program where he starts to sing, and I just sing it back to him. I think, how am I doing like a monkey? You know, how am I doing? Am I getting it? And but he was doing this one thing over and over. He would only sing a half a sentence, and then I'd have to sing that half, and then he'd give me the second half. Finally, I said, what about getting a whole sentence? And he said, hey, man, I really can't trust you with a whole sentence. He said, if you know what you're going to say, you won't be saying it. Now, gets a little hurty, doesn't it? How many flow in the spirit in music, singing the song, singing the spirit along? You know what that's like. You get these good things that sound so good, you're like, whoa, boy, do I sound good. And then it goes into you, blah, 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 and these words that are just so stupid start coming out, and it's like, and the heavens opened up, and I was really impressed. You know how it is. It's the idiot of the year is singing again. And so the deal was, if you agree to sing half a sentence, I'll give you the other half. Once in a while, he messes with me and doesn't give me the other half right away. And I'm like, they're really messing with me. Don't do that. But he's been very kind. Anyway, I said all this to say, it's because the Lord is being carried as a burden. Why? Does he want to go somewhere? Here's the secret. The Levites ministered in the tabernacle before the presence of the Lord for 33 years. Isn't that funny? 24/7, 33 years. Jesus walked on the earth 33 years. Do you think it requires praise for the Master to place his feet upon this earth? Wherever he's praised is where he can come. If he's not praised, you're probably not going to see him there. Got a better reason to praise? That one there works good all by itself, doesn't it? There's a lot of other ones, but that one would really work. Now, if he's going to be carried, now here's what happened in those times. After they stopped carrying the box around, Kenaniah, chief musician, these are very in key words. You're going to love this, I think. Kenaniah, chief musician, he said, he was for song. That's what the scripture says. 1 Chronicles 15:20. Kenaniah, chief of the Levites, was for song. He instructed about the song because he was skillful. Now, that looks like a pretty innocent sentence, except the word song is burden, the exact same word used for the burden of God. So what he said is chief of the Levites, Kenaniah, was for the burden of God, and he instructed about the burden. So what he did to the next generation, here's the other key to this, and I'll say these really quickly so you can get it. The next generation always carries the burden of the presence of the Lord. The scripture says, and when the sons of the Levites, not the son of Levi, the sons of the Levites carried the Ark of the Covenant. When they did that, then the priests began to make sacrifices. Here's what happens. It's a generational concept. our children, our next generation, will carry the burden of God's presence. And then me, older peoples, are to make the sacrifice it costs to help them carry. Are you catching that? Now, it's a little trickier than I first told you. I've sucked you into something that will hurt your feelings later. Jesus speaking, anyone who's heard and learned from God would come to him. So we got heard and learned. He's speaking from Isaiah, and he's speaking these things. If you've heard and learned, which is the Hebrew word teach, and it takes five words to get Hebrew, basically Hebrew. And if there's any Hebrew scholars here, I beg your forgiveness for butchering something I should be studying much deeper. But I say this to say, in Hebrew, and I won't try to pronounce the words, they're beautiful, but I would mess it up. But what I want to explain is what it looks like to be taught in the Hebrew. It looks like five things. It means to have water thrown in your face. It means to have your heart pierced with an arrow. It means to be hit at the back of your legs with a stick. It means to be a light in the distance. And it means to illumine or to bring illumination. So we want to instruct you a little bit about song here. We got a pail of water here we'd like to instruct you with. I have my best bow and arrow, my marksman standing over there. And I have a stick for your legs. I mean, that does not sound like teaching to me, does it you? We're used to the Greek form, which is to talk about it until our face falls off. Take 10,000 notes and bring them home and say, I have me one heck of a sermon in my notes today. And would I live in a moment of that? I doubt it, because it's in my notes. I don't have to live that. I have it in my notes here. How many times do we do that? God is an experiential kind of God. We're talking about the Passover is experiential. It's not, oh, the Passover. No, bitter food in the tent, hang out back, you know, all night. It's an experience. Feast of Booths. It's an experience. I want you to experience. Tell your kids what it was like for you to walk to school 5 miles every day. Tell them, and they love to hear it, don't they? Take their shoes off and walk 5 miles. Then you got their full attention. It's experiential. So God was teaching them experientially. This is what's going to happen. So he's got this teacher going. Now we come all the way to Kenaniah. He's trying to teach the next generation how to carry the burden of God's presence. You carry it in a song. Let's go to the instruction. What does Kenaniah do? He instructs. He instructs with, water in the face, an arrow in the heart, stick at the back of your legs. I'm guessing that the instructions were reasonably, how should we say it? Harsh? Would they be harsh? Now, we want to move into the arts, and this is how God is being carried in this next season. He's being carried through the art. Now, instruction's going to have to be involved. What kind of instruction? Well, let's just talk about it until your face falls off, you know. Why don't we have some experiences? Why don't we live it? Why don't you play the worst song you've ever played in your life in front of everyone so that you can feel how good that feels? Let's worship God. And everybody goes, that's not to your stuff. Now, one of the things we are as the church, I almost thank you for it, but on the other hand, I think it has really been destructive. If you play poorly in the world, you're fired. That's all. You play poorly in the church, it's bless his heart. You know. That's what we do, and I just don't know that that's really cool, not before God. And I played in lots of different churches and in a lot of different environments, you know, and one guy played clarinet in high school, and his clarinet is sitting on the stand. It'll be there all week, sitting there, and he'll come back up and squeak on that thing, and but I'm, oh, I love God. How's the worship? That reads a little old, ain't it? But it's worshiping God. What God? What God are you talking about? The God of mediocre, that one there? The one that always takes the higher sacrifice? That the one you're talking about? The one that people died if they had a bad idea when they ministered to him? Is that the God we're talking about? Don't take this offensive. Don't get crazy. The reason why I'm giving you all of this is because God is upgrading everything that we think we know. And we have not understood yet the level of excellence he wants to release. It was because we're busy trying to get some credit for it as quickly as possible. I've been in the music business. I know what it looks like. Okay. Are you okay so far? Now, one of the things that have happened to us in our time is our young people who, I was a young people. In fact, I've been 17 for a very, very, very long time. The only thing that's not 17 anymore is how quick I get up. And this hair. This hair is not 17 anymore. But everything inside your being, I mean, how many feel that way? How many, you know, when you act your age, act your age. Why would you ever want to act your age? Golly. Wouldn't it be, never mind. What I discovered, and this is in the music business, is a fascinating place to watch things because it parallels the world and it parallels the church tremendously close. And one of the things the music business is about is dealing with quantities of people. They want to deal with people. How do you deal with them? Aside from the fact they want to rip them off, but aside from that, they want to please or get the attention of a lot of people. Does that sound kind of churchy in its own little way? In order to do that, you've got to find ways to get the young people's attention, because everybody is convinced they're the buying public, or the young people. So how do you get their attention? I don't know. You play something loud, okay, turn it up louder, all right, yeah, that's cool. You do something violent, yeah, that'll work, yeah. Get them to kill each other on a CD, okay, yeah, let's try that. They'll try anything if they think they could sell it to you. And the reality is the acts that are out are not really sincere about anything. They're sincere about making some money. And the music that they're preaching is really doesn't mean anything to them. It's just a way to make some bucks. Now, let me tell you how it kind of got there. And because I know that this can be a little bit confusing, but I want to make some serious, say something serious. Music's intent was to encourage the hearts of people. Music is actually not worship. Your offering is worship. That's praise. When you lift your voice to praise, you're praising. This is only an encouragement to get that to happen. And if it's done really well and it pulls on your heart, then it gets you to go, ah. You know what I mean? And the greatest compliment, believe me, a musician can hear is, boy, I could sure feel God's presence today. To them, it's like golden words. Because, oh, yeah, it happened. You know, I played something that encouraged you to move towards the King and that you want Jesus more. And you walk out of here going, whoa, I like Jesus better now than I did. Not, I love that band. You know what I'm saying? And that is a difficult thing to get to change in us. Now, in the early times, and I'm stuck in American history because that's all I really know that much about, but I have a suspicion it's probably very similar here and maybe even similar in the world, but I can use our history and our mistakes and you can benefit from it if you're okay with that. When we were in the 20s, in American music that is of the 20s, it was weird and everybody hated it. All the young people loved it and the older people hated it because it came off of the era of the classical music, which is the late 1800s, pretty much. And then the Charleston, which is kind of nuts and crazy, which was people danced and prohibition was there, nobody drinking. So they got into little nightclubs and got drunk and danced. Oh, that we could return to that innocence. And so what wound up happening is the music form changed a lot of people's lives. Roaring 20s. We got into the 30s. At the end of the 20s, we have a Great Depression. Now, big bands started in America because nobody had enough money to be an individual act or a quartet or a sextet. There was just too little money. So big bands came into existence. You could have 30 pieces, no problem, because then nobody had any money and you give them all a buck a piece and you got a big band. That's how big bands came to pass. Because they were starving. So they have guys like Benny Goodman and Tommy Dorsey and Glenn Miller. Nat King Cole had a small band and a big band later, and they sang of these groups, Patti Page, Ella Fitzgerald, more people were in those times. The music encouraged a very depressed people. Keep in mind that Tommy Dorsey was 21 at the time. He was a kid. He was a kid. He wasn't an old guy. He was a child. And all of these musicians were. Frank Sinatra was in his mid-20s when this all started. Now, they sang a music that encouraged the heart of a very depressed people, and they were falling fast. At the end of the, by the beginning of the 30s, Hitler is rising up, and we're really having trouble, or by the end of the 30s, rather, we're having some serious trouble, and now we're into World War. And the music was used to encourage people. Now, to us, we think that music is being used to lull them into stupidity because we need to rise up against the government. But let me show you something before you get crazy with me, okay? It ain't your creative responsibility to tell a nation what is right or wrong with its government. It's your responsibility to do what God is inspiring you to do in your heart. That's what we're here for. And if he's calling you to encourage a people who are in war, then do it. Are you hearing me? Don't stick your thumb in their eye and say, I know what's wrong and right, because I am from America. We do not know anything that's happening anywhere in the world. No matter how much you watch the news or read the papers, we are completely uninformed. And we think we got it all. That's the worst part about being uninformed, is you're so uninformed that you don't even know you don't know. And so to make any kind of a really rational judgment would be insane. Forget, write a song that might become popular or famous as a result of your very missed conception. Now, I'm going to get you some other stuff. By the time you got to the 50s, the whole concept of encouraging a people through music was starting to break out. You could make some money selling records now. And so this became a business. We get into the 50s, and a young guy comes along. His name is Bill Haley, and he writes a song called Rock Around the Clock. Not really an intelligent song, but very cool. You know, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, rock. Yeah, baby, bad. What are you shaking? I don't know what I'm shaking. I just don't know how to dance. And it was pretty innocent. The lyric wasn't too smart. It was the beginning of rock and roll. I think it was a great idea. You know what I mean? It was fun. We came out of depression and war. Wouldn't be a bad idea to have a little stupid fun, you know, without any real high-level intelligence on it. Movie producer comes along, grabs the song, and says, I'm going to put this as a theme song to my movie called Blackboard Jungle. What's the movie about? Oh, it's about teenagers who don't want to go to school, and they rebel against the school teacher, and they beat him up, and they go out and stand in front of the jukebox and sing Rock Around the Clock. Yeah! Am I losing something here, or is that the stupidest thing you've ever heard? Let's beat the teacher up and go stand around a jukebox, and the rebellion is the victory? What the heck are we talking about? That became a cult hero, that film. It started riots in cities all over the United States. Kids stood in front of the theater and started fights in front of theaters, and it became the theme song of a nation. Meanwhile, Bill Haley is a 30-year-old guy. They describe him kind of balding, very shy and unassuming. The last thing he wanted to start was a rebellion. He was trying to get a hit. I'm just trying to write a hit, man. You see what I'm saying? Now, when the two medias came together, the two mediums, if you will, came together, they began to produce a rebellion in the hearts of young people. Now, it seemed reasonably innocent. Oh, that we could return to Rock Around the Clock. End of the 50s, this thing is becoming full-born. Elvis Presley shows up, and he does look like the right guy. Do you know what I mean? He's got all the moves, man. He sounds great. The songs are happening. Everything is coming together. Then we move into the 60s, and suddenly things are not looking as good as they should. Vietnam War begins. people are smoking pot. They feel like, now I'm smarter than life itself. And the music begins to rebel against the nation. It's no longer encouraging a people in war. It's teaching rebellion in the middle of a people. What did we get out of that? Well, we got a lot of really weird things started to happen. This is the part of it because it's something that was close to me in my own life. Anti-war songs were going crazy. And it was a huge move in America, sparked by song after song after song. Big hits on the radio, Martin and John and the war songs and the eve of destruction. And the kids were just, yeah, and they were madder and madder. And this style, this music that was supposed to encourage a people who were in a war they didn't want to be in and watching their kids come home screwed up and messed up, they didn't want to see that. There's no encouragement. We think that's denial or naive. Wake up. You're not here to present the world with its own problem. You're here to encourage, to live. Yeah, it's got a problem, but you're not helping that problem by taking this beautiful thing God gave you from the heaven called a gift of art and poisoning people with your very uninformed version of it. Are you catching me? Am I hurting your feelings there yet? Good. Charles Manson came out of the 60s. Thank you very much. What do you suppose the heart of that was about? 75,000 young men were killed in Vietnam, Americans, young Americans. After the war was over, I ministered to a good many Vietnam vets and did some concerts to raise money for the outreaches that tried to reach the vets. After the war was over, 150,000 of them committed suicide. More than twice as many men died after the war than died in the war. And that number is still raising, is still going up. What is it that caused them to feel so violated and so unwelcome in their own home? Could music have anything to do with that? Could that have poisoned a whole nation of people? I can't remember who actually said this, but give me the song of the youth and I will give you the nation. Yikes. That's a pretty strong statement, isn't it? Now, by the 70s, we got David Bowie, Black Sabbath, led by Ozzy Osbourne, he's a sweetheart. Elton John, Jackson 5, Janis Joplin, Jimi Hendrix, Jim Morrison, dead. I'm talking about musicianship. Do not be hearing me. I'm just talking about people and lifestyles and what they're feeding in. Now, these people may have never wanted to be a part of the rebellion, but when you're in the music business, they will dictate to you what sells. And that's the end of that sentence. There's nobody's ever played what is in their hearts. I'm in the music business. Kiss comes along at that time. Their name often is signified as Knights in Satan's Service. Hip-hop was born. Billy Idol. Sid Vicious. Where's this rebellion going now? 80s, Madonna, Motley Crue, AC/DC, Def Leppard, Prince, Poison, Public Enemy, Guns N' Roses. The drummer in that band sued the band because they forced him into doing heroin, and when he went into rehab, they fired him. And so he sued the band for being fired. Now, these people are leading millions of people. They're not just, oh, a guy had a mistake. He made a mistake. Well, yeah, he made a mistake, but he's also leading millions of people, of your children. Are you catching where I'm going with this? Boy George, Culture Club. By the 90s, Nirvana, Ice-T, Metallica. I won't go on any further with this. It gets much worse. Are you catching where I'm going, though? Okay, now we got rebellion at full tilt. Now, this is how this starts. And it's because, and I gave you that little scenario, we decide somewhere along in our lives when we're young that I won't listen to a tested person. Bob Jones. You guys know who Bob Jones is? Great white-haired prophet guy, one of the finest dressers in the country. And one time somebody gave him a hard time about a word that he gave. You know, I don't know if that's from God. I'll tell you right now. We've been getting us another prophet around here and listen to the junk like you're talking about. And Bob says, well, if you want to wait another 35 years for God to test another prophet, go ahead. Or you can shut up and listen to what I'm saying. I like Bob. We got some choices in these days. We're going to start ignoring, and what's really started to happen is God has raising up the spirit of Elijah in this nation and in our nation, where he is turning the hearts of the fathers to the children and turning the hearts of the children to the fathers. This is the first time that this has really, really happened. I've been a musician all of my life, and as soon as I turned 30 years old, there wasn't a young person on earth that would even give me the time of day, much less pay any attention to what I might have said or played. You're too old. You're fired. It's out of here. The record business during that period of time was hiring 18 and 19-year-old executives, riding their 10-speed bikes to church, smoking a joint. That's who was running the music business. Duh. Where's the leader? Where's the father? Anything that's birthed requires a father. Is that correct? Or it will go to pieces. Because there's nothing to guide. Now, what happened in an awful lot of young, and it's in our house now, it's in our houses now, in the young people. I spoke with some young. We were going to do a record. They asked if I would help out, and they wanted to do a Christmas record. And the first thing that they wanted to do is to just butcher old Christmas songs. And I said, well, I mean, I get you, I get the change. I get that you want to do something different with the Christmas song, but can you play me this song the way it's supposed to be played? Can you just play it one time for me? Just play the song the way it was written, just once. Well, no, I never tried to play it. Oh, you mean you're improvising on what you really don't know then? Well, I just think the original way of playing it isn't all that cool. I'm okay with it, with you changing it, but please don't change something that you don't know. Know it first. I used to play with Chuck Mangione for years. That sounds like I'm bragging, but one of the things he would always say, play my melody before you play yours. If he wrote the song, play my melody. Of course, he has the right to it, man. Don't improvise on something that you don't know. But what would have happened, for me to look different, okay, everybody played the song like this, and I want to be different, so I just play it like this. I just jump over here and wreck it, dishonoring its original form. Correct? Now, really true musicians will take the original form, study it, understand it, play it well, and improve on it and make it their own, called an arrangement. Does that make sense? Now, if you've not got the gifting to do that, then maybe you shouldn't be recording. Do you see what I'm getting at? Now, this is not to say that we can't make young and great sounding music, and much of it is awesome and wonderful. But to step out without any fathering and without any guidance into what you're stepping into, you're going to make another step. Is that true or not true? That'll probably go south on you before you get there. And then you make a music that you and seven other of your friends love, and the rest of the world goes, I don't get it. And you're out of it. Because you only got a few tries. If you didn't know that, you've only got a few tries at being public with whatever you do. I'm giving you a music business 101. If you ever want to be public, don't be too fast in how you approach it. Make sure that what you're giving is indeed public. and not just your own little personal vendetta. You're hearing me? You're not hearing that. Never mind. It's one of those things that has to happen. Now, we'll get biblical here so you can think that I know what I'm really talking about. Between the generations, there's always going to be a division. Christ, he said it to us. He said it in Matthew 10, 34, 36. Do not think that I came to bring peace upon the earth. These are words of Jesus. I came to bring a sword to separate between father and son and daughter and mother-in-law. Do you know those scriptures? Do I read them all, the whole thing? Of course, and he goes on to say that if you love these, you love your children or your whatever more than you love me, then you're not worthy of the kingdom. We all know what this all means. So if he's taking his time to divide us, but here's what division means. I brought a sword to divide you. And that means a disunion of your opinion. So it is from God that our children do not agree with us. Are you hearing that? It's from God. To get them to agree with you is a serious mistake. Are you understanding? But to get them to grow through what you're training them to do, now that's what you're here for, not to make them agree with how you think. They're not going to like the music you like. That's fine. They don't have to like it. But don't dishonor when you're growing into your own. And what we have trained our young ones to do is to dishonor in order to be different. Now, the reason behind all of this, and it may seem pointless to make a point out of this, is because we're approaching God with dishonor as well. Are you catching that? And that's what's not going to fly in this next season. 1 billion souls, Bob Jones' prophecy, is coming to salvation in the next few years. 1 billion souls. And they're supposed to be focused on the young people. That means there'll be a lot of tattoos across here, a lot of spikes, a lot of stuff, a lot of mohawks, a lot of stuff going to be here. Going to be fine. It'll be just great. They'll be wonderful. You'll love them. They'll be a mess. Half of them drunk, half of them drugged, and the other half trying to figure out how to get that way. But they're going to show up, and they don't know why they're here. And they're not going to hear your religious platitudes and metaphors. They will not pay attention to that because they've been trained to rebel against anything that looks or smells like churchianity, my favorite new word. So what we have been doing is trying to figure out how to make it okay for them to be what? Like the world? It's okay. Let's give you something that's like the world. It's a little bit like the world. It's almost like it. We painted it really brightly. Are you catching me? That's not going to touch young people. They need real, they need strength, they need authority, and they need someone to walk in the governmental place that they were given by God and not give up any part of it. When they see that, they will not only respect it, they'll come under it and honor it. But we keep trying to figure out a way, gee, the kids are really bored in church. How do we keep them? How do we keep their attention? One time I did that. I was leading worship and I was watching some young people just, while I'm leading. You know, and of course I'm leading every man-pleasing song I could find because it fit. You know, we want to do horizontal worship this week, and then we'll do blood worship next week, and then we'll do vertical the week after. And that was how the plan went. I think that's a good plan, but those teenagers didn't. They didn't hear any heart from what was coming from. They didn't care about the style. Are you hearing me? They didn't care about that. They just didn't hear any of this. They just heard me singing what I thought the leaders would like. And they fell asleep. They hated it. They hated it. God, says I, why do the young ones hate true worship to you? And he said, they don't hate worship to me. And it isn't me that they're bored with. thank you, Lord. I needed an adjustment. My neck was getting a little stiff, and thank you for that adjustment. Heavenly chiropractic works every time. I got to do an outdoor thing with the kids and a lot of the people of the church, and we were going to do an outdoor thing, and I was going to lead worship at it, and we had a bunch of kids there, and they were running around, and I said, you know, I want to invite all the kids up, and I'll play anything. I'm just boogie and groove until I can't stand up, but just do what you feel like. You want to dance? You want to run around up on here? Go ahead. Have a time. You know, kids looking at their parents, you know, and I said, hey, it's okay. Let them, you know, give them a minute. Goodness, let them do something. Well, the kids, and they ran around and they shoved each other off the stage. You know, it was just bedlam. You know, and the elders and the parents were like, ha, 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 you know, couldn't pay attention for 5 seconds. I'm not promoting this, but the place needed a de-stiffening, and the kids went absolutely ballistic. They just had the biggest time of their lives. Next week, they show up in church, they're looking at me like, can we do that again? You know? I said, yeah, I'm just glad to see you looking up here and not that look on your face. A month of this went by, and the elders and leaders and were like, I'm having a fit. This is really driving me crazy. You know, I can't worship God. These children are driving me out of my mind. Some of the leaders began to take the kids and teach them to worship, teach them to move in the spirit. A couple of them said, hey, let's get with them. Let's dance with them for a while. Let's have a good time with them. 2 months later, that place on Sunday morning was on fire to worship the Lord. And every kid in the house was jammed up against the front of the stage, and they were like, yeah, let's move. And they enjoyed themselves, and parents enjoyed themselves, and people began to come and get saved in this stupid little place that nobody expected anyone to ever accidentally come into. What is this between the generations? The gap is big, isn't it? It seems insurmountable because we don't know who we are. When I began to, I use the word lead worship really loosely. I've never really considered that I led worship. I've led a couple of fights, but I don't know that I've led any real worship. I feel like that is in your heart. You're either doing that by yourself. You don't need anybody to lead you into that. If you don't do that on your own, then do that on your own in Jesus' name. Get that as a gift. But I was determined to sing what was in my heart, which God was saying, I'm giving you my heart so that you can sing it. And he began to show me this thing about what it meant to communicate this way. And he said, if you can deal with being a non-existent person, he said, I want you to feel and sense the heart of this people, and then I want you to sing it to me. I said, yeah, that'd be great. What are they thinking? He said, you want to know that too. And I would sense the people. We can feel people. This doesn't take anything special. If you're a musician, I know that you know the temperature of the water of the audience that you're standing in front of. Is that correct? I mean, you know what I'm talking about. And there's common sense things, but then there are things that you can really start to hear their heart. If you begin to sing that heart to God, he will answer them. And you've got yourself a conversation between the king and his people, fulfilling the original scripture of the Levites that said, I will prepare a sacrifice before God that is acceptable to him. What used to happen in the Old Testament, they would bring in animals, bring in sheep or rams or goats or whatever they would do and bring it in. And the Levites had to prepare that sacrifice so that it would be acceptable to God. And then that person would have his sins cleansed or whatever. We don't do that anymore. There's no longer blood sacrifices, but there is a sacrifice of praise that has been offered. When you come into this house, you have hopefully praise in your hearts. You enter the gates with thanksgiving, and you come into his courts with praise. And this band is supposed to read your heart and see your sacrifice, offer it to God, and then God's go, yay and amen. And that accepting speech will come back through what the king wants to say to you. Thus, you get a conversation with God, you hear from the heavens, and we got communication. There's no age limit on that one, by the way. When that flows freely, the generation gap is broken. No young person or old person doesn't want to feel the presence of God. Are you catching me? We have probably 597 opinions on what is the presence of God. But the truth is, the real presence does do this one thing. We all know when that knock you on the floor presence is there, now don't we? We got that one. Got that one. The one I can't breathe under? Yeah, I got that one. Because he's a burden. Now, here's the next stage, and I'll try to give it to you. I had a prophetic word spoken to me one time a few years ago. And it is a prophetic word spoken by a prophet. I'll just tell you that right up front. And the word was, you're the ass that carries the presence of the Lord. Prophecy out of King James, of course. And it caused me to really ponder for a while on what that might be. After I got over the insult, I said, I bet that was a compliment, I think. But I realized that music was intended to carry the burden of God's presence. And that little donkey that went down through the streets of Jerusalem was only a signal of it. It was basically, if you can hear this, the gift that you carry, be it music, be it art, whatever it is your donkey that you carry the presence on. Now, truth is, many donkeys have a cross on their back. We talked about that earlier. Elizabeth talked about that. But here's another fascinating quality of God. He rode a foal of a donkey. Do you remember that part of the scripture? Did anybody see a foal of a donkey lately? A full-grown human being cannot get on the foal of a donkey. It would break its back or hurt its legs. Secondly, you get on a foal of a donkey and bring it into a street where people are screaming, Hosanna! Blessed is he! They're waving palm branches and throwing their coats on the road. A foal of a donkey, an untrained animal, would do what? Probably freak out, go panic, go ballistic, and then, is that Jesus going up there? Yay! Way! You know. That could have been a very, very unique experience in Israel's history. That moment in time could have backfired real bad, you know what I mean? But what we have is the next generation carrying the burden of his presence, incapable of actually holding up his full weight, and yet he could. Incapable of containing his own heart with the shouts, but he did. But he did. We need to bring Jesus in between the generations so that he can settle both of us down. That was the secret word. He settled them down. He got on that foal of a donkey and rode right straight down the street. People freaking out, totally ballistic. If anybody thinks that wasn't supernatural, you are dreaming. That was probably one of the, probably his biggie. That was probably his big one. Raising the dead was nothing compared to, never mind. The second part of it, and this is for all artists who carry an anointing in their artistry. The donkey can only carry one. It can't carry the church. It can't carry two. It can't carry anyone but the Lord. Because anything bigger than the Lord will break your back. So he proves his burden is light. His yoke is easy because he mounted up upon that with which could not carry him. So, all the way back to the Levites, and the scripture is really cool.
1 Chronicles 15:26. And it came to pass when God helped the sons of the Levites to bear the Ark of the Covenant, the burden of his presence, that they offered the bullocks and the seven rams. That's when they made offerings. Do you know the story of when David brought the Ark back up into Jerusalem? You knew that he put it on the Ark, put the Ark on a cart for a while, and Uzzah got smoked as a result of doing that, and so on and so forth. It's a great lesson. They're all beautiful lessons. And so when they finally got it out of Obed-Edom's house, you know, and took the blessing away from him, I got to bless this jerk. We're going to get up there. And they carry the Ark up into there. Walk six steps, stop, sacrifice. Six steps, stop, sacrifice. Six steps. Somebody tried to measure the space. They think there was probably 2,600 sacrifices before they got up into Jerusalem. Do you think God is interested in going somewhere? We think he wants to go somewhere. No, he just wants to be exhibited on your back. Because he wasn't going anywhere in Jerusalem either, other than to the other side of town. That was it. Now, what I want to do is not point out how hard it is to figure out how to get the young people to do what you want them to do, but to get to that place that we experience this Elijah anointing that's coming upon the young and upon the fathers and the mothers, because the Lord is raising up mothering fathers and fathering mothers. Did you know that? Capable of really doing the job in both directions. My favorite statement was from the old man Arthur Burt with a T, who's 99 or 98 now. And he was asked this question when he came to minister. What part of the fivefold ministry are you? And he said, what do you need? Isn't that really what ministry is? If you need a prophecy, no problem. I got it for you. You need a healing, I got it for you, no problem. A little teaching, I can give you teaching, no problem. Apostolic, I can put the crusher on you just like anybody else. You know what I mean. This is the time when we are beginning to be awakened. Now, with artists and musicians, no matter what they are, a mentor is a pretty powerful thing. Is that correct? Does anybody know what I'm talking about? When I was a young musician, I had my own nightclub, Christine and I. It was a coffee house. I was in my 20s, had been playing the guitar for about 12 years, drew a crowd every night. They thought I was great. They thought I was great. So did I. And they would crowd in there, smoke joints, and listen to us. And I was singing my stuff and doing my thing. And proud of my way, I played. And one night, a classical guitar player came in to visit the club. It was a well-known after-hours place because it served coffee and other things. And he sat in and played. He was brilliant. He made more music out of the guitar than I'd ever, and I just stared at him, and I just thought, oh my God, in a lifetime, I could never play like this. And I was like, oh, listen to that, listen to that. I mean, I was taken, totally taken by it. When he got off, I said, that's wonderful. I don't know what to say to you. I said, that's so wonderful. And he looked at me and he said, are you serious about the guitar? I said, yeah, well, this is my nightclub. This is my guitar. These people are here to see me. Yeah, I'm serious, says I in my smart aleck way. And he said, well, you don't even hold it right. Well, how do you hold it? He said, come over to my house on Saturday and I'll begin to show you. Yeah, I'll come over. Yeah, I'll check it out. Yeah, I'll check it out. He said, don't bring your guitar. Don't bring my guitar. I'm going to play one of your guitars, I suppose. So I get over into this guy's house, and we begin this process. And he begins to, first of all, have to break 12 years of very bad habits. and begin to awaken something inside of me that I didn't think I had. And everybody here is carrying some kind of a creative gift that I guarantee, as I'm breathing air, you do not know the depths of which that can be awakened. You just know what you're doing. And you just do your little thing, whatever it may be, and you think that's it. I'm peaking. People compliment me. I'm peaking. I got it. They like me. It's over. Wrong. And he began. It was 5 years. I spent 5 intense years with him. And he broke every bad habit I had and awoke and awakened a whole thing that I didn't know that was alive, that could be even be alive. And finally he said, I'm not trying to teach you to be a classical guitar player. I'm just trying to keep you from stopping yourself. And I thought, what a wise thing to say. And then one of my favorite statements that he would make, he said, the reason you practice is so when that music decides to use you, you won't be offering a bunch of excuses on why you can't do what it's calling you to do. You might want to reword that with the reason to practice the gift that God has given you so that when the Holy Spirit decides to use it, you won't give him a lot of lip about how you can't do that. Pretty good idea, isn't it? If you keep growing in that area, if you keep coming alive in that area and letting him bring something out in you, he will carry you to places you can't imagine. You ever seen this young girl, Akian, is that her name? Am I saying that correct? You ever see her work? Read her poetry? It's like this little brat is like 11 or 12 years old and has this amazing, amazing gift. Where did this come from? Why would God do that? Because he's beginning this next season. He's jumping over the top of all of the stuff that's in the way at the moment. Am I talking to the right people? There's stuff in the way that we are not going to see easily until we recognize we have been up against a wall, a creative wall, for probably 30 to 50 years. If you listen to the greats in the music, if you listen to Mozart for a few minutes, he was commissioned by the church to write what he wrote. Was this guy a little left of center? He could write all that stuff on one piece of paper, just keep doing it. How is he doing this? How were any of those guys doing that in those times? Why isn't it happening today? It's beginning to stick its head up again. Do you know what I mean? Because the creativity world, the world of creativity, is about to supersede the concept, I guess, of capitalism. If you got a gift, then is it worth anything? Is that painting, can you sell that thing? Is it worth anything? I don't know if I'd bother painting that if you can't sell it. Why would you write a song like that? Who's going to buy that? You know what I'm talking about. Now, because that got into our young people, it really also messed up a lot of the generational stuff. Am I making sense so far? All right. What I think would be really a key or important to do is to maybe move into a time of forgiveness, for starters. I know that guy who decided to mentor me, I hope it was because he saw something in me. I hope that's what that was about. But he gave up a lot of his life to teach me. And he was a teacher. He was a wonderful teacher. But he gave up a lot of his life to do it. I quote him to today. I wish he knew the Lord. I wish I knew the Lord when that was all happening. But I got to tell you something about the training process that we have got to awaken to as the body of Christ. When someone comes to me, a young person, and said, where can I learn to play the guitar? What Christian organization can bring that to pass? And I don't have an answer. I said, I don't really know one, to tell you the truth. But I know where you can find a walk with God. Now, they're going to come, and they're going to come in an awesome way. And they're going to be looking for fathers, and they're going to be looking for mothers, and they're going to be looking for true authority, not feigned authority, and not the kind of stuff that demands respect. be reminded, authority all by itself demands respect out of those that are before it. If you tell someone you're supposed to be respected, chances are that's never going to really happen. But it begins to happen in the spirit. And first, the Lord will release the spirit of authority on many of you, and you'll know it. Some of you are already fathers, already mothers, even in the gifts and the arts that you're doing. If you want to grow in the gift, start ministering it as it goes. My teacher used to say to me, I love these times together because you're pushing me, he said. Because you eat it so fast, you're pushing me to go to stay ahead of you. Because, man, I couldn't eat it fast enough. I couldn't just glommed off big chunks. And he would say, good, good, good. I got to work harder to stay out in front of you. And he did. He never failed to do that. Thus the scripture fulfills the scripture. Now, how many young people are here under 18 years old? Really? It says something by itself, doesn't it? How many here are 21 and younger? 21 and younger. Were you forced into coming, or did you really want to come? You were forced? No, you really did want to come. Okay. How many unforced 21 and younger people are here? Come, if you don't mind, would you mind coming forward and making a spectacle of yourself for a little while? Oh, good. Thank you, Lord. Goodness. Stuff all over these guys, isn't there? Goodness. This is great. What is this group with this shirt? You're a family. Wow. Is that how you don't lose the family? You get the same shirt. Okay. This is good. Thank you, Lord. There's so many gifts up here, I can't even get a hold of how many are here. Wow. First thing I want to say to all of you is I want to ask your forgiveness as an older person for thinking that you weren't paying attention when you really were. And I want to ask your forgiveness for not standing in the place that I'm standing in for some other older people, if you will, if you can hear this, for not nurturing the wonderful things that are in you that I see on your faces right now. And some of you may have been nurtured beautifully, so don't take this as a personal offense. But some of you didn't. Some of your gifts weren't nurtured, and some of the things that you're all about were not nurtured and didn't come forth. It was too impractical. So I just want to ask forgiveness that we've missed too many things and that we didn't know what it really meant to care for you in the way you were supposed to be cared for concerning your gifts, the gifts of the Spirit and the creative gifts. How many of you paint? You do painting? How many like to draw? How many are musicians? Ooh, a bunch of that. I gotcha. There's hardly a kid in the world that doesn't draw or scribble on something. And look how few hands went up when we said, how many draw? Because in their hearts, they don't believe they can draw. And they don't believe they can paint. Because somehow, that got crushed. That soon. That fast. But music looks like it has a future. Do you understand that? So we get a lot of hands. But I'm going to tell you that you can draw. I'm going to tell you that you can scribble, if you like. I like these t-shirts. I'm guessing they were done by one of you guys, huh? Your grandfather. Oh, that's wonderful. That's wonderful. He's probably cool, isn't he? I bet he is. That's a gift you guys have. That's a wonderful gift to have. So we ask you now, Father, in the name of Jesus, that you will forgive us, this generation that has walked in denial, literally. And we ask that you would release the creative gifts again, a second time. All of the gifts that came from birth that either got overlooked, bypassed, or stepped aside, that you would release the power of your grace upon each one of these again, and that you would re-up what you gave them to begin with. And we ask that you would release the power of creativity upon them, give them songs of the Spirit, give them songs that would never die. They would take the hearts of a nation, that they would absolutely take people by storm, that they would draw pictures that no one could take their eyes off, that they would go, wow, what heart is in this? And that the colors that they choose to do their hair is a beautiful sight in your eyes, Lord. Even though we get prematurely blue, it doesn't mean that we cannot still move in the power of creativity, because all over her is color and the beauty of color and how much she loves it and to see it and to enjoy it. And it had to come out in more than just crayons and paints. It had to come out in other ways. And so many of them are right there. That's their spirit. Now we ask you, Father, that we will not only bring these gifts back, but double the speed with which they move in them. So for every year that was lost, that you didn't move in the gift that God had given you, would be a double year given you back. And that you would double that double year until we look at a whole bunch of Achaeans, a whole bunch of early Mozart, who wrote his first piece at 9 years old and 11 years old, and an amazing, amazing gifts. So we call upon the heavens for witty inventions, and we call that the Spirit of the Lord give you the highest possible gifts, and that you walk in them and live in them all your life, and not be afraid. And I speak this to you now. Don't be afraid of the world, for you have overcome the world. Don't be afraid that your gift would not be accepted in the world, but be assured that your God is bigger, and he has overcome this world in you, and he's overcome it in your life. Don't worry about falling prey to the trap. God has already sprung the trap, and there's only one caught in it, and that's the enemy. Now, Father, we pray that you will release a spirit of forgiveness and the spirit of Elijah upon these young ones, that they would begin the process of turning to the fathers, looking for the answers in the faces of the gray-haired ones, because they're all around you. They really are. And some of you think they're just old fools, but even in the eyes of an old fool is wisdom if you find it. Find it, dig it up, search it out, find it, and you will grow in leaps and bounds far beyond your years, far beyond the wisdom that you already carry, and many will follow you as you begin this process. Are you hearing me? We pray that you will awaken in their spirits every aspect of this, every aspect of the creative arts would come to pass, for you will lead virtually thousands to millions of people to salvation. But you must hear this. It isn't for salvation that God gives you this gift. He gives it to you because he likes you. Just because he likes you. And he loves to see what he created creating. He loves to see it coming back at him. He loves those little pictures. He loves that song. He loves that midnight melody that you've had in your heart. He loves the prayer and the innocence of your life and your heart. He loves that stuff. Now release upon them, Father, now. Now each one of you that are musicians, I call you forth in the name of Jesus as a chief Levite. I call you into the fray I call you into the place that music will begin to move prophetically in you. You will play the sound and someone will say, I don't know why I'm here, but I'm hearing a sound. You will play the sound again and you'll play it again and you'll find a heart full of song. And I call you into something that may look above your head, but I tell you now, the Lord is raising the water so that you can float on it. You can float on this water. It is the time. And I call that gift forward. I call that gift out in you. And I say in Jesus' name, be full of the Holy Spirit. Let him play you. Learn your instrument or whatever you're doing, singing. Learn it so well that you no longer need to figure out how to do it, but let the Spirit play you. Let him sing you. Let him dance you. Let him be through you until when looking at you is just like looking at Jesus, just like looking back at his face. And we no longer battle with what will someone think of me, but what is my Father saying? What is my Lord say? How is he dancing today? How good Jesus looks dancing on your feet. How good he sounds when he sings in your voice. How wonderful he is when he plays through you. This is the gift that God wants to release. Now, from an old generation to a young one, I say, come on, come on. God's got the stuff. Come on. You can do this and more. You can do everything we have done and more. Don't worry about fighting what you already know. Just take on and go farther. That's the secret. Learn from this age and go farther. Make your floor the ceiling, our ceiling. Make that the beginnings of your lives. That's the secret. These things feel exciting in your hearts. How many are feeling that in your belly? A little excited about it? It's good, isn't it? That's because the Spirit of God is moving in your stomach. He's moving in your spirit, and that's how he's doing it. He's touching you now, and he's already giving you things. You can already think of them now. If you had something in your hand, you'd be writing it or drawing it or playing it. It'd be happening now. And may this not go asleep ever again in your lives, and that it awakens. Now, I call you to the next level, because it's going to come in levels, and I call you up to this next level. It's a level of hunger. And it is an undying hunger for the Word of God and for his presence. And every time you enter into that music, his presence will be there. And it'll become addictive to you until you're like, God, I gotta get in that presence again. I gotta get in that place again. I just gotta feel him one more time. I've gotta sense it again. And that thing will grow in you and it'll increase. It'll increase until suddenly you say, it doesn't matter what's happening. I've got to be before my king, and I've got to play, and I've got to do whatever he's made me to do. When that happens, this world will change because you will be the infection that changes it. The beauty of his glory will be upon your lives. Now, I pray, Father, that you will seal these things in the awesome name of Jesus and that the enemy have no rights to any one of their lives. We cancel the assignment of Satan against you right now in Jesus' name. We cancel the assignment against your minds in Jesus' name. We cancel the assignment against your physical bodies in Jesus' name. We cancel all assignments of confusion and of inadequacy. That word you'll have a hard time pronouncing because it's about to disappear from your vocabulary. And the Lord would say to you, run in such a way as to win the race. Don't compete, just win. That's the secret. You guys are very beautiful, especially to the eyes of the Lord. Bless you guys. Bless every one of you. Amen. How many older, I say older people, obviously older than 21, yeah, feel they have been feeling a pull towards fathering and mentoring and that sort of thing? So you are getting that, so it is happening. What happens to us is that our lives, you know, Satan will see to it that you don't have 8 seconds to do anything other than what you're doing every day. So you're going to have to just chisel a hole in time and say, I'm giving this time away. and it'll cost you. Well, there you have it. It costs. Well, let's see. What doesn't? Let's figure it out, if that's what's really in your lives. Now, young ones like this are going to be asking. They're going to come, and they're going to ask. And if that's in your heart, to stand with young ones and to be with them, to not control, but to guide, to not take over and live your life through them, but to nurture, to recognize their gifts are greater than yours ever could be, and be glad of that, and be happy that they can do what you couldn't, and go where we were too afraid to go. If you can stand to do that, then you probably have father or mother stamped on you. Amen. All right, fathers and mothers who feel that call in their life, stand up and we'll just minister to you for just a second. Did you want to do something before that? My goodness. With these amount of fathers and mothers, not a single one of these kids should fall through the crack. Am I talking to the right people? Did you know it takes an entire community to raise one kid? I know you know that, but if you see a kid that you know in your neighborhood or whatever that's getting out of line and you say absolutely nothing, what does that mean? We're still responsible. Father, we ask you now in the name of Jesus that you will continue and you will complete the spirit of Elijah that's beginning to pour out upon these people that are called fathers and mothers, and that you would pour out again the next installment of father and mother spirit, and you would break a generation gap now, and that you would place Christ Jesus right in the center of this generation gap, that there'd be nothing but Jesus. If you look back, you'll see Jesus. If you look forward, you will see Jesus. That works. And the problem is that we've been looking at us, and it's the end of looking at us. It's time to look at Jesus. It's time to see him in between the generations and his great abiding love for you and his great abiding care for you. If there are the parents of any one of these young ones want to come forward, you can come and lay hands on them or comfort in any way you see a fit to do that. Also, those fathers and mothers that are not even having children, not even have children, but would do whatever it took to carry the burden of a child in your heart and even in your life, to teach whatever you can teach. Believe me, they'll come to you. Just like I found my teacher. And I just said, whoa, look at that. And he said, if you want to know, come to me. Those two sacrifices. I had to see it. You have to humble yourself before it. And that's how you'll recognize it in the young ones. The ones that are willing to humble themselves and learn what you have will be the ones that you can pour your lives into, and they will receive. They'll get it. Don't try to break a hardened person, because Jesus hasn't finished breaking them for you. You'll see it on their faces. They're willing to learn. And if you don't see that, just wait until you do see that, because he's getting them all. And we pray extra blessings on the relationships between fathers and mothers and children, sons and daughters. We know that the scripture said that Jesus came to bring a dividing sword. That sword means a disunion of your opinions. It doesn't mean he came to separate you as father and son or mother and daughter, but to change your children's opinion so that they could have their own life. When they grew up enough, they could hold to their own realities. And you could strengthen that by saying, I made you strong enough to stand when it was time to stand. And that's what that means, to have a disunion of your opinions. Don't be afraid if the kids don't like the music you like. Don't be afraid if they don't like anything you like. Love them. Watch them grow, because they will not stop. They will not stop. We ask you now, Father, that you will give this gift to the children, that they stop performing for their parents and start being children for their parents. Stop trying to perform to the expectations that's been set down for generations. But live in life just like God made you to be. In the name of Jesus. Now, Father, we pray that you will seal this Elijah anointing, being reminded that Jesus called John the Baptist the Spirit of Elijah. That means the Lord is releasing John the Baptist all over the nation. A voice is shouting in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord. That's what's on these young ones, and that's what's on these fathers now. The voice that shouts, prepare the way. Through your union and through the agreement that you have made to be father, son, mother, daughter, through these agreements, you're breaking the power of rebellion, and you're breaking the power of the enemy released upon the nation that has destroyed nation after nation after nation. And now it changes. Now it turns. Now it becomes life. Now it becomes life, and we are not willing to lose a single one of them, Lord. We are not willing to lose one of them. Nor is our God. Now we ask you, Father, that you'll begin to unite the army that's in this room. And the army would say, mess with one of us, and you're messing with all of us. Take one of them down, and you're going to have a fight with every single one of us. You mess with someone in the body of Christ, and you will have the entire body on your neck. And that's what the Lord is trying to build up, a body of people who will never let go of who they are and why they're on this earth, and teach them how to stand in the gap for one another until it is accomplished. Not until it is almost finished, but until it is done in the name of Jesus. This is the power of the Lord that he wants to release upon this hour, in this place, in this time, and for a time such as this. Let it be in the name of Jesus Christ, the Lord. Sorry, that one. Yeah. You want to do it? Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I have such a strong burden upon me in regard to this, because we understand, of course, this is for individuals, but it is also in the intercessory place. You're standing in, of course, for your age bracket, of course. But beyond that, I felt this was, I felt like the Lord saying, this was such for the cultures, that there's so many it's multicultural here, and that I just wanted to say that I really feel that this is a release for the nations. It really is. There is a release for the nations. And that your like shadows and types, and that everything that Don was speaking and blessing and prophesying over your lives is for you, is for your age bracket, but it's also for so many cultures in the nations. And that I felt so strongly that what you do with your lives, even as you walk out your lives before the Lord with your particular and unique giftings, you are operating in that place of intercession, and what you do with your life and the expression of God through your life is impacting and changing nations, particularly the nations of origin that are within your bloodline. So I really wanted to release that to you tonight. It's very, very, very powerful time. As we said, there is a birthing tonight that we have no idea. You know, when birthings happen, you have no idea the impact. But this is very, very impactful. We don't strive or strain, but when the Lord does something, the invisible comes to earth and it manifests, and things are different. And so things will be different now. There's a release that's already happening. So it's different. It's changed.
Can we thinking to have the 20 to 30s come. This is probably the most skipped over generation ever, but to come. And blessings on each one of you guys. If any of you are 30, you can, 20 or 30, you're 21, okay. 20 to 30s. Mm-hmm. Right. If you're on the edge of that, you know, we're not trying to be too strict here.
Yeah, I felt so burdened in that there was really, you know, a refiring for this age group. I feel like for some people, as Don was ministering in this place of just the mentoring and the care giving, that there was it wasn't available and that the Lord really wants to give to you what you didn't get. And again, for you all, you represent you're an age group, you know, and you have not been passed by. You have not been passed by. And we really want to break that off of you. And as you stand in, we want to break it off of your age group. That your age group has not been passed by. It's not too late. And I mean, see, look at this, how many there are of you. And y'all are so strategic. And so I just want to ask, as Don did, I want to ask your forgiveness. And as this is an intercession that's going forth, we are asking the forgiveness of your age group that was passed over, that missed the mentoring and missed the fathering and the mothering and almost felt cast aside. And so I just in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I release that forgiveness to you. But I also lift off of you the spirit of an outcast. I lift that off of you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I lift that rejection off of your spirits. I lift all isolation off of you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and all lack of belongingness. Whoa, I lift off every spirit of orphanhood where you, whoa, 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 ha, 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 that's right, whoa, whoa, whoa. Yeah, we lift off every spirit of isolation and separateness, inability to connect with yourself, all self-separation. I lift that off of you, off of your spirits in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I lift off all false titles. Any that you are not a name brand. You're not a name brand. You are unique and individual. You're totally unique. Any place that there has been written into your spirits or your souls that you have been written off, I lift that off, that lie off of you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And also the lie that it's that some of you have already bought into the lie that there are certain things that's too late for you already. It's too late for you already. That's a lie. And I lift that lie off of you now in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. It is not too late for you. It is not too late for you at all. Well, I lift off any generational patterns of hopelessness and despair in the name of Jesus. I lift off any generational burdens that you're carrying. Many of you are intercessors, you're prophetic, you're worshipers, you walk in revelation, and you walk in a lot of intercession that you haven't comprehended, and you've actually been receiving burdens from your family line, your generational line, and from your culture that are not yours. And you have internalized a lot of beliefs and misconceptions about yourself and about life that are not true, and they're not yours. And so, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, right now, I lift off I think I need to lift it out. So in the name of Jesus, we lift out of your spirits and your souls. That's right. And we transfer to the Lord Jesus Christ all false burdens. Woo-hoo. All false responsibilities. Woo-hoo. All blame and condemnation and accusation that settled inside of you, we lift off of it. We lift off of you all internalized pain, because as intercessors and burden bearers who have not understood your gifting, you've actually internalized a lot of pain and suffering and torment through some of your friendships and some of the things that you've subjected yourself to. So we release the cleansing of the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ upon you right now, spirit, soul, and body. Woohoo! And we lift off of your minds right now. We lift off of your minds. Listen, do this with me. I want you to, if you're interested and willing, would you just renounce all cultural mindsets that have been anti-God or anti-Christ? You willing to do that? So in the Father, in the name of Jesus, we just want to repent for and renounce all cultural mindsets that are anti-Christ or anti-God, wow, that we have appropriated and internalized as truth and have agreed with. Woo-hoo. We renounce those lies in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Wow, and we receive him, wow, as the way, truth, and life. Wow, in Jesus' name, amen.
It's good. Now I want to pray over you a Father's blessing. For so many of you, it did not happen in your life. And I want to bless you in the name of Jesus. I'm going to bless you. I want to bless you that you would move in the life that you were meant to move in, and that you will not be disappointed, because I am not disappointed in you. I do not see a failure. I do not see something wrong. I do not see that you have not lived up to what you hoped to be or what your Father hoped you to be. You are more than what was hoped for. I bless you now. In the name of Jesus, I bless you as a father, and I bless you and say, you are beautiful. You are so much more beautiful than you can know. You are so much more exceptional than you can know. There is a greater thing in you than can be spoken of in words. And there's a beauty that is developing that is so wonderful that no one could even speak of it. So I bless you to the depths of your soul, to the depths of your spirit, and speak it over you, and know that the Father in the heavens is well pleased with what he sees, as I am well pleased with what I see. My eyes do not behold anything that is not pleasant. It is wonderful to my eyes, and you are full of grace and full of glory and full of the Holy Spirit, and you will live in that all the days of your life. All the days of your life. I bless you in the name of Jesus Christ, the King over us all. Now be well. Honor, love, care for, nurture, and grow into young men and women that rule nations, that rule companies, that rule people, and change the ways of life all over the world. For God Almighty, with the spirit of grace on your face, the spirit of love in your heart, and the Holy Spirit on your lips, and that your words become his words. And all expectation that has been put upon you, I break off now and place a Father's blessing in its place. In Jesus' awesome name, amen. And amen. And amen.
And I just want to bless you too as culture changers. We renounced the false lies of this culture, and you're now released to be the culture changers that you are. The Lord Jesus Christ, in and through you, the kingdom of God is come. The kingdom of God has come upon you and is in you. And you, I just bless you to become those releasers, those culture creators. You are culture creators. You know, you're world changers by the very essence of who you are in the Lord Jesus Christ. And we totally renounce all shame off of you, off of all of you. Not one of you is a mistake. Absolutely not. Not. Absolutely not. And remember that you're representatives of the kingdom, and just as we said for the younger ones too, for you as well, your lives as you are before the Lord, walking in the identity he's given you, with him empowering and living through you, you're changing the world. You know, we hear a lot of world changer. You really are changing cultures. And whole ethnic groups will be changed as you walk uprightly now, knowing and believing the truth. Yes.
Well, I'm glad you're alive. I'm glad you're here. Amen.
Just when Don and Christine were just praying that over us, I just thought that it would be a powerful thing if all of us could turn around and just speak and repent on behalf of our generation and speak life into the older generation as well, if we could do that. So if I could get all you guys to turn around and all of everyone who's sitting down to stand up for us. And if you guys at the front could make this like... If you guys could pray and repent just in your own words as well, don't necessarily just follow what I'm saying, but just pray and bless these guys in front of you and also repent just on, then just start going for it and release the blessings on this old generation. So, Father, we come before you humbly, and Lord, we just ask, Father, that you would... give this generation so much more life, Father. God, we just ask that these next however many years, whether it be 20, 30, 40, or even just a few years, Father, we ask that you would make these years the best years of their lives, Father. And Lord, we come as a generation who has rebelled, and we come as a generation who has, you know, turned up our noses at the older generation and said we know better, and who has come and tried to do things our way, and you know, we just repent on behalf of that. We repent to you guys, and we just say, you know, where we have taken charge and where we have decided that, oh, forget it, you guys don't know what you're doing, we're going to go ahead and we're just going to do what we want. Where we've said that, then we repent and we say we're sorry. And I believe that there's a bunch of you guys here who have children who aren't here, but there's a bunch of you who have children who have rebelled and they've gone out on their own in the world. They're doing whatever they're wanting to be doing. And I believe that just on behalf of them, that us as a group here just want to repent and just say, we're sorry for just disregarding what the Lord has given you and disregarding the wisdom that the Lord has given you. And we just say, come and accept us as a generation, and we want the wisdom that God has given you guys. We want the wisdom that God has given you guys. We want the wisdom that God has given you guys. We want it. And Father, because we've rejected it, Father, God, we repent to you and we say, God, don't let the wisdom that you've given to these guys, to this older generation, don't let that wisdom pass us by, Father. We want that wisdom. We want the wisdom that was meant for us on this generation. We want that wisdom. Father, we want that life. And we speak a huge blessing into you guys. We just ask for new dreams. We ask for where even the world and culture has told you guys that you're too old to dream or you're too old to go for it. We just break that cultural lie off you and we say, you are not too old to dream. You are not too old to go for it. Start dreaming and start going for it. Start dreaming and start going for it. Start dreaming and start going for it. And we ask for huge financial blessings over you guys. We ask for huge financial blessings. You know where we even as a generation concentrate on ourselves, on praying for our own financial breakthroughs, for our own dreams, our own destinies. Well, we just stand here and we say financial breakthrough to you guys. We pray supernatural healing and supernatural life into you guys. We ask that the rest of your days and the rest of your years would be full of life, that there would be no sickness that hampers them. And Father, we accept your call, Father, as not only a generation who is to get under the older generation to learn off them, but we accept your call also as helpers, Father. God, we accept your call as helpers. And Father, we ask that, even where we have rejected the older generation saying, well, they can just fend for themselves and do whatever they want, Father, then we say, God, that us as a group here, we choose tonight to get behind these guys and to help them, Father, and to be there. God, we are one army. And Father, we want to know our roles, God. We want to know our roles as a younger generation and the older generation, how that fits. And God, we want to fight as an army together and as an army that covers generations, not as two separate armies or anything, Father. We want to be an army. And God, we love you. You are absolutely amazing. Would you just come and show us how we are meant to do this, God? Because we're really all at a loss, God. We are really all at a loss without you. So we ask you to come and show us how it is that we fight together as a generation, as two generations and as many generations, Father. We love you heaps. If you guys at the front have any like prophetic words or like prayers that you want to pray for these guys, and go up to them and like start praying and prophesying over them, I think. Like just go for it if you get anything.
If you don't even have a word, just hug a young person. Just go and hug a young person, because it's not that you're going to be ahead of us or behind us. I think we're going to link arms and that we're going to walk into the army hand in hand. Just find a young person and just hug them if they even don't have a prophetic word.
If you would like ministry, there's those that were sitting in the seats that didn't get any ministry. If you could go and stand underneath the flags, our ministry team will come over. But if I can have the ministry team just come to the front here, because we're going to need some catchers. If you're on the ministry team and you need a catcher, if you can just raise your hand. If you would like more, if you would like ministry and you haven't already received it, if you could go stand at the side, just be very careful how closely you are to the pictures. Don't stand on the last row there. And if there's not enough room, then we can stand along the back. So ministry team, we would need some young men that would be willing to catch for people. That would be really great. Ministry team, just keep your hand up. Laura, can you just put some music on, please? We want to pour into you. Those that are going on the line right now, just begin to receive. Just begin to hold your hands open to the Lord.